Hello, scholars. My name is Dr. Kara Stillen, and the goal of this channel is to make academic subjects easier to understand. Sorry for the delay with this video. I've been putting out a new podcast called Reading Between the Lines with Dr. Kara Stillen. It is a liberal podcast that looks at the psychology behind Washington's politicians and power players. You can find this podcast on Spotify or other podcasting apps. In the last video, we talked about deviance and crime. And in this video, we're going to talk about technology and innovation, so let's get started. When I headed to college in 1995, the internet was just coming of age. I lived a childhood with no internet, no cell phones, no GPS, no Fitbits. Heck, we thought having a basic calculator on your watch was super techie. Technology is not a product of the modern era, though. Technology and innovation have always existed. Homo habilis, a relative of Homo sapiens, created technology by sharpening the edge of rocks, making cutting tools. This allowed the species to cut meat from the flesh of dead animals to eat. The wheel was invented in 3500 BCE in the Eastern Hemisphere and greatly changed the transportation of supplies and people. For those of you that keep journals, it would be totally interesting to write down what new technologies are being introduced this year and then take a look at this entry 10, 20, or even 30 years from now. The technology and innovation that will exist in 10 to 30 years will probably stun all of us. As much as technology and innovation tend to be positive, there are definitely inequalities that exist between those that have access to it and those that do not. Depending upon the technology introduced, sometimes it can lead to a greater division between socioeconomic status, race, and/or age. When the internet first became popular and started to spread across the globe, a digital divide took place. This digital divide also led to a knowledge gap concerning those with access to technology versus those that did not have it. Nowhere was this more evident than in school districts with young children. School districts with plenty of funding were able to bring in computers early and establish classes teaching students about the internet and its sources. These students gained a great advantage over students that did not have access to this technology, especially when it came to higher education and the workforce. The speed of the internet, cell phones, smartphones, high-speed internet, electronic fitness equipment, Amazon, social media, and the introduction of artificial intelligence have changed the world at a pace that very few of us can keep up with. Even though the price of laptops have decreased greatly since the mid-1990s and into the 2000s, the price of computers are still too high for those that are poor. Many poor and minority students only have access to the internet on their phones instead of on a computer. This puts them at a disadvantage for finding jobs and filling out applications. A cover letter and a resume are generally of much better value when they're created using a PDF or a Word document as compared to online via a cell phone. Another disadvantage of cell phones is that many individuals feel that they cannot shut their phones off and have time away from them. Almost half of cell phone owners state that they sleep with their phones next to them in their bed. Almost a third of people state that they cannot live without their phones. Nearly three-fourths of people engage in some form of social media through their phone, and these individuals admit to checking their social media more than once a day. With all the use of smartphones and the internet, there has been an increased concern about personal privacy and security. Identity theft and personal bullying are destructive issues that have increased given the use of the internet and cell phones. Large businesses have been hit and significant amounts of personal data have been leaked to hackers and identity thieves. Companies have been created to protect individuals from identity theft, but these protections cost money that most people do not have. There is no doubt that technology is increasing at such a phenomenal rate that society isn't sure how to deal with it. From the invention of the printing press in 1450 to the evolution of the internet in the mid-1990s, the rate of transporting information has almost been exponential. In 1450, the news you created could probably reach 40, 50 people in a day or two. Now, a post you make could go viral to a million people within seconds. With the addition of the internet, other forms of media have suffered greatly. Newspapers and their popularity have declined substantially, and many companies have had to take their news online in order to survive. As the younger generation who's been raised on YouTube gets older, television will need to change if it's going to continue to survive. The use of digital ads have increased substantially with the use of the internet. Before the internet became popular, television was the main source of information and entertainment for individuals and families. During the week, parents would go to work and children would go to school, and they'd all return home at night and watch the news as well as their favorite programs. If the programs were good, they would all return to work and school and enjoy talking about those programs with their friends. For many years, there were three major networks, including CBS, NBC, and ABC. Advertisers competed for various times of the day or during people's favorite shows. Television definitely influenced how people saw themselves, especially within their own societies. 98% of homes had a TV in the 1990s. Television programs taught social norms, values, and beliefs. Technology tends to spread across the country as it becomes cheaper and cheaper for consumers to purchase. This is also the case in various countries throughout the world. Once the internet made its way to various poor nations across the globe, it greatly helped those in absolute poverty to begin to grow. The internet allowed for more competition for those selling products, and individuals could find lower prices given the goods they wanted to buy. Mobile banking has gotten better as well, which has also helped others to succeed. Let's look at the three sociological theories in relation to technology and innovation. The first sociological theory is functionalism. Functionalists investigate how technology helps contribute to the better functioning of social institutions and their communication with one another. There are commercial functions, entertainment functions, social norm functions, and life-changing functions that are part of technology and innovation given the fundamentalist approach. Companies that introduce new technologies and innovations show off and try to sell their products using commercials and advertisements. Advertising takes place almost everywhere through billboards, at movie theaters, in social media, on television, within podcasts, on the radio, on vending machines, on a program for a show, in a magazine, and so forth. Advertising companies can make big money if they know how to find certain audiences to play to the values and belief systems of those people. Entertainment is another function of technology and innovation. A good example of this is through television or movies. When streaming of movies and TV shows was invented, this allowed people to access their favorite entertainment at the push of a button. They could watch what they wanted at home, on public transportation, while waiting for an appointment, or even in their cars. Innovations in gaming as well as chat rooms allowed people with similar interests to meet and become friends, or even strike up a romantic relationship. When individuals are using new technology and innovations, they're also partaking in certain socialization processes. A person may believe that they're being entertained by a new program that they're streaming, but the program might also assist in establishing certain social norms, values, and beliefs to that person. All items that are produced for the masses teach its readers or viewers something about how people speak, what is considered acceptable versus not acceptable, and how people should react to various situations. Many immigrants that arrive in new countries not only learn language through programs, but they also pick up much about the culture and what it values and believes in. Has technology and innovation led to consequences within our society? Has it changed our lives in ways that aren't very positive? The fast-paced flow of information could result in increases in anxiety and depression as people become overwhelmed by what to pay attention to. The second sociological perspective is the conflict theory. Those that believe in the conflict theory of sociology state technology and innovation are owned by those that have money, power, are of a certain age, and are of a certain race. Not only do these sociologists look at technology, but they also look at who controls the media, how the media promotes certain norms over others, and how it minimizes all aspects of the working class. Powerful businesses have a big say over what technology is produced, when it's released to the public, and what certain media can say or do. This is known as gatekeeping. Messages are shaped for the masses in an amount that people can handle. New forms of media can stifle the influence of the dominant media and shift the worldview. YouTube is a very good example of a company that greatly changed the way media produced its information. One of the significant topics that is addressed at length by conflict theorists is the use of various surveillance in society. With the increase in technology, various sociologists fear that an all-powerful and all-knowing government, which was described in the book 1984 by George Orwell, will somehow come to be. Facial recognition systems, fingerprint analysis, optical scans, and cameras everywhere are quickly moving the U.S. toward this type of surveillance. The lack of person-to-person communication has increased substantially, which may not be to the benefit of society. Even though this type of technology has great advantages, such as being able to locate someone with dementia if they take off or can't be found, there are negative consequences that could eventually take down society. The last sociological theory is symbolic interactionism. Those sociologists that believe in symbolic interactionism look at technology and innovation in terms of symbols. Even technology itself can represent a symbol of someone's status in society. Those individuals that have an Apple Watch, drive a BMW, have the latest smartphone, and answer phone calls from their earbud may be seen as having a higher status than others. Symbolic interactionists also look at how media can construct reality. If the same messages are provided by multimedia sources, people will begin to judge themselves and their own actions by comparing themselves to what they're seeing on the media. Businesses that form brands are extremely good at forming society's realities. They promote their products in ways that society believes it cannot live without them. Companies do this by massive amounts of advertising and create scenarios where buying their products makes a person feel more like they belong and are part of what other people are enjoying and identifying with. Well, that is the end of our video on technology and innovation. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have a favorite technology or innovation that hasn't come out yet, I'd love to hear about it. I am fascinated with technology and think the world of inventors and idealists. If you like the video, please click that like button and don't forget to subscribe. Have an amazing day, and I'll talk with you soon.